Show Racism the Red Card is an educational charity campaigning to get rid of racism in our society. The campaign is backed by top stars from the world of professional football, such as James Milner, Enny Aluko, Cesc Fabregas and Gary Lineker.
Personally, I used to look around and see, you know, he's a really good player, he's a midfield player, he's not that good, but he tries really hard. And you don't think, well, he's black and he's, you know, he's got an Asian skin colour, or he's... I just don't understand why you would think like that. Show Racism the Red Card.
Show Racism the Red Card.
I want you to stay here beside.
Show Racism the Red Card.
I won't be okay.
Sácale tarjeta roja al racismo.
But racism isn't just about skin colour. This film is about immigration and people who move from one country to another and often experience racism and prejudice. It seems like every day there's a story in the media about immigration and everyone's got an opinion.
We're just kind of afford to have millions of them just trying to get into this country.
There seems to be a lot of people trying to get into the country and not a lot of things being done to kind of stop them.
We do need to stop a lot of people do coming into the country because obviously it is putting a lot of people under the poverty line themselves.
It needs to be sorted. There's too many people coming into the UK.
I think immigration is the big issue at the moment. Like, most of the people are talking about immigration.
I feel that immigration can be a good thing.
There's a lot of people who are incredibly confused about it. I think that they've been reading the wrong newspapers, and that's where they're getting their opinions from.
I don't think there's like too many. I mean, there's not enough to, like, the scare tactics that people use. I don't think there's that much.
Well, we're only a small country, and all these immigrants that are coming in, there's going to be no houses for them. There's going to be no jobs for them. They've got to do something about it.
There is more people are crossing illegally the borders. They're coming behind the trucks, they're coming behind the van, the boats, you know, all this. So, yes, we'll have this problem. As long as UK is here, we'll have this problem.
I don't think that what is portrayed in the media is necessarily a true representation of the problems that there are.
The country was built on immigration.
I think people just need to relax a bit more and just, yeah, not be so really heavy on with it, really, I think, sort of full on. To be honest,
I think it's a really positive thing and people need to be a bit more clued up about it.
Although we're all talking about immigration, the number of people who are in the UK who were born in another country is quite small, about 13%. And many countries around the world take in far more people than the UK. And of course, immigration is not a new thing. People have been coming to the UK for centuries. Many of us have parents, grandparents who moved to this country. Immigration is part of British history.
There's nothing holding you back. It's not a...
Jermaine Defoe was born in London and played football for England, but his grandparents came here as immigrants.
My nan worked in a sugar factory, Tate and Lyle. My granddad worked in a meat factory.
Did they ever talk to you about kind of what it was like when they first moved to Britain?
Yeah, it was difficult, especially for my nan. She obviously came here, didn't speak any English at the time, didn't have no money, no job or anything like that. And yeah, it was really difficult. But yeah, just that fighting spirit that everyone's got in the family, you know, to keep going and to make something happen, make something of yourself. And that's what they did, my nan and granddad.
We've often relied on people like Jermaine's grandparents, hard-working people who came to do important jobs when the UK was short of workers. In the past, people from many different places have come here to work. Irish workers came to build houses, railways, and help to develop the infrastructure which we rely on today. And during the First and Second World Wars, many people from other countries came to fight for Britain. Thousands of servicemen and women from allied countries came to help this country in the fight against fascism, the Second World War. Sheila, who worked as a head teacher, was born here, but her mother, who worked as a nurse, and her father, who joined the RAF, came here as immigrants.
Both of my parents were immigrants to this country. My father from Jamaica,
and my mother from Southern Ireland. My father joined up to the RAF. He came to join the fight against Hitler. And my mother, she came to England as a nurse, and she trained as a nurse in London.
But although immigrants came to help Britain, often they faced terrible racism. Landlords refused to rent out rooms to black and Irish people.
They were victims of the no Irish, no blacks that was going on then. They had great difficulty finding somewhere to live. Yeah, I can remember comments like, oh, your father's really a gentleman. Oh, he's in disbelief that, you know, my father was well educated.
John Amiobi moved to Newcastle in the 1980s from Nigeria.
I arrived Newcastle on the 1st of October, 1986. That is as a student to come and do a PhD. It was an experience that I have actually cherished, because when I came, people were warm towards me. There were one or two occasions there was a racist abuse and stones were thrown at me, but that was I don't look at it as a serious thing at that time. Okay, they should go home, you black, and but it's just one of, you know. But generally, people were warm, people were understanding, and so on and so forth. And that was my experience. Yeah.
But you're a strong character. You can understand how, that might affect somebody else.
You are quite correct. You are quite correct.
With a different disposition.
You are quite correct.
Back then, in the 1980s, racism was much more commonplace in everyday life. John's sons, Shola and Sammy, both became professional footballers for Newcastle United. But they too sometimes suffered from racism at school.
It was not easy for them at that time.
Is it something you report to your teachers and things like that?
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's something I definitely report to my teachers and let them deal with it, because I think that's the best way to handle it. You can sort of get yourself in trouble if you're the one trying to deal with all the abuse you might be getting.
Soft errors creeping into the whole game as Amiobi scores!
Immigration is complicated. People from the European Union can move freely from one country to another. So that means someone from the UK could move to Poland, and someone from Poland could come and live in the UK. But people who come from outside of the EU often aren't allowed in. So for example, it's difficult for someone from, say, China or India to move permanently to a European country. The European country with the most immigrants is Germany. And of course, many British people are themselves immigrants living in other countries. We talked to a range of people who moved from one country to another. Mercedes is a Spanish woman who came to Britain. Why did she come?
I always knew I wanted to live here, since I was a child. I don't really know why.
If you just go for what you actually...
I'm a trolley dolly. I'm a cabin crew. I'm a supervisor. A normal day, for example, for me might be waking up at 4 a.m., getting at the airport at 5:45, meet my crew, talk to the pilots on the amount of flights we're going to do, the passengers, any type of weather conditions that we might expect, and then get the passengers on board, keeping them safe, serving them tea and coffee. I don't feel myself being an immigrant when I'm here, but I know some people might feel it like that because obviously I'm not English. I don't see why should we put limits on the way that people move to one country or to the other. I understand that, especially in the media now, that everyone is saying, oh, you know, we have so many immigrants and they are stealing our jobs. No one steals your job. The job is there, and if you are prepared enough to take it, you will take it. I don't see why should we put a limit on that.
So Mercedes came here from Spain, and many British people moved to Spain. Around 300,000 British people now live in Spain. Many Polish people work in the UK. Mario has worked at Nissan building cars and is now a self-employed bike technician.
I'm Mario Ilewicz from Poland. I came to Northeast to the UK in 2007, about 8 years ago. The main reason was to change something in my life, but also to find a job. Northeast is great, friendly people, and that's why I settled down in Newcastle. My first job was in a Nissan factory because I'm an engineer myself, and I'm technically skilled, and then I made the decision to self-employed.
Some people say that immigrants come here just to claim benefits. Is that why Mario came?
Not really. I personally don't use this system, the benefit system, because I don't have to. I work and I can't afford living here. Yes, we try our best, and I hope that there is a majority of Polish society who honestly work and contribute more than they take. And this is what I do myself.
Beth works for the trade union movement in Newcastle, but she was brought up in the Lebanon.
I grew up in a very small village called Ibel El Saki, amongst a United Nations camp, protected, you know, very secure, however, you know, during a difficult time. So when I was about 9, you know, my parents made the decision to move back over to the UK, to the northeast, where I've got a lot of family, to basically set up a new life for me, my brother, my mum and dad. I think the UK needs highly skilled workers. I think it needs people who can work hard and contribute to society, contribute to industries, and migrant workers do that. They do that by working, they do that by contributing through paying their taxes, through spending in local communities. And I think if we lose out on immigration, we could lose out as an economy.
In the past, when Britain was short of workers, immigration was encouraged. And even today, the National Health Service is short of nurses, so hospitals often recruit nurses from other countries. But these latest immigrants still suffer from racism. Brenda is an NHS dental nurse from Zimbabwe.
It is sort of like the caring profession, really, that people go into. And the NHS is really staffed by immigrant workers. I think racism, when you're an immigrant, is a part of life. It's something that you unfortunately get used to living with, and you just deal with on a day-to-day basis.
Nolly and his wife Jenny moved here to work for the National Health Service as nurses.
Somebody will, like in the street, will say, "Hey, Joey, go home. You're not needed here. Go home." That's it. But the only thing that hurt us most is, like, you know, little children. You know, supposed to be the future of the future of the generation,
yeah.
But they're the most of the time they're the one who's doing this. Even vandalize our car. One time they even broke one of our door glasses on the door. Their front panel was broke. They smash it. They're throwing eggs in our windows. Everything.
It's sad that a nurse who is here to do a vital job in the UK, who was asked to come here, should receive racist abuse and be told to go home.
Like, our next door neighbor is very nice, but people along that street, yeah, some of them. That's why even my children cannot play outside. So they just stay indoors, you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Daria is from Russia and now works as a teacher. But what was it like when she first moved to the UK as a child?
When I was 10 years old, my mum worked as a translator. She had done through most of my life, and she had met my stepdad just on a chat room on a website, and they went to Prague to meet. And when my mum came back, she announced that she was getting married and we were moving over here. Understandably, I was really upset. I couldn't imagine being torn away from Russia, which is where I was born. I remember being placed in the bottom sets at school just because I didn't speak the language. So automatically, you know, everyone just kind of assumed that maybe I wasn't so bright. And when I started picking up the language, I moved up the sets.
Did you get any help, like, racing for being Russian?
Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of xenophobia. I mean, I still get it now, but I think what I found really difficult was that people would kind of take the mic and they would laugh and make silly comments because they thought, oh, well, this girl can't speak English. And I could understand it, but I would never have said anything because I was just too shy and I wasn't confident enough using the language to say anything back. So while they thought maybe I didn't understand what they were saying, I did, but it's just I was too scared to do anything about it. I want you to stay here
beside. Eni Aluko is an England footballer.
Well, I was born in Nigeria, in Lagos, Nigeria. Descend from Nigerian parents, both my parents are Nigerian, and I came to England when I was very young, so probably about 6 months old. For us, it was just, you know, we're very pleased to be in England and, you know, just pursuing whatever sort of happiness and goals that we wanted to as a family.
Sadly, there's a lot of negativity and sometimes hostility towards migrants in this country.
Yeah.
Have you got any advice for children who may well be in schools and have come from other countries and are struggling to fit in and get on?
I think my advice would be to be proud of who you are and where you're from. I think that would be my advice. I was always taught to embrace, you know, my Nigerian background, but also be very proud of, you know, being English, being part of, you know, British culture as well.
Many footballers are immigrants who've come here to work. Here's Manchester United and England's Chris Smalling talking about how good it is to work with people from different countries.
Especially this season, I think nearly half the change rooms from sort of all over the world, so it's quite interesting to see you have sort of people from sort of Brazil, Portugal, Spain, how it differs to our culture. It's more difficult for people that are coming into a different culture they're not known. You need to try and meet halfway, and I think that helps in all walks of life, whether it be meeting people on the streets, whether you're working at a bank or, as you say, in a football club where you do get to meet a lot of different cultures.
So should we see immigration as a positive thing or something that we should worry about?
There's certainly a trend towards blaming, I think, immigrants towards, you know, various things, whether it be claiming too many benefits and so, and the truth is that doesn't really, you know, they bring in far more than they cost, if that's the right way of describing it. You know, they come in and do a lot of work, they bring, I think, a lot towards our economy is actually the fact.
People have migrated to Britain from all over the world and have given Britain a really vibrant culture, have contributed lots of skills. You know, as I say, my dad was a radar engineer, my mum was a nurse.
The vast majority of people coming over here are here to look for work. Obviously, some people can say, oh yeah, well, you know, they're stealing the job that I'm entitled to. But in most cases, those are jobs that either people don't want to do or there's a shortage of.
It should be regardless of where you come from, what colour your skin is, what religion you are. We're all just human beings trying to make the most of being here. Just say yes,
'cause I'm aching, I know. Whilst many people choose to move to another country to work, some people have to leave their home country because it is too dangerous to stay. Asylum seekers and refugees are people who are fleeing war or persecution and need to find a safe place to stay. We spoke to two refugees. Omar is from the Gambia in West Africa. We haven't revealed his identity in case this leads to problems for his family back home. He was in Germany when we filmed him.
So I was in a group like a political opposition party called the UDP. That's the time we were arrested and taken to the police station without no charges, just saying that we are organising illegal gatherings.
So because he was part of a group which was against the government, Omar was put in jail. He was frightened that this could happen again, or even that he might be killed. What could he do?
Then I decided to take the route to reach Europe where I can have safety. And it was a very hard choice and decision to make because my family is in the Gambia, my mother is there, my sisters and brothers are there.
To try and reach Europe, Omar had to pay to travel in the back of a pickup truck hundreds of miles across the desert to get to North Africa, where he would try to get to Europe across the sea in a small boat.
Imagine you travelling in a pickup truck which runs in a very, very high speed for 7 days.
And how many people in the back of the truck?
Yeah, we used to have like 28 people in the back of a truck. After three days of driving in the desert, we came across a car which has broke down more than some weeks ago. We found out that everybody there was dead, and it was about 31 people. There are many, many people buried in the desert, all victims from this.
From the smugglers.
From the smugglers.
Eventually, Omar reached Libya, a very dangerous country in a state of war.
Libya is the first place I start seeing guns and hearing the sounds of guns like an everyday routine. That's where you have to pay for a boat trip to enter Italy.
So from the Libyan coast, it is possible to get to Europe over the sea, but many people drown in dangerous and overcrowded boats.
I have witnessed an accident when I was coming here from Libya. A boat which sank in the Mediterranean. It was carrying 95 people, and all of them died until only one guy was able to survive. We traveled throughout the whole night until the following day, then we see a very big ship. We realized that it is the Italian Coast Guard. So those are the people who rescue us. We are very happy that we make it alive.
Many thousands of refugees have died trying to escape to Europe. Agnes is a refugee from Rwanda.
So in 94, most of my family were killed, and we spent days and a month, you know, hiding from people who were committing genocide.
So after her family were killed, Agnes spent over 2 years as a child in a war zone in Rwanda and the Congo.
People were dying from not having enough food, not having enough water, not having even good water to drink. To be honest, people were dying everywhere. Even though these things was happening, nobody would cry. We did not have, there was no emotional there. I was about 89 at the time. Being child was the worst thing that could happen to you. Being a woman was another worst thing which could happen to you in the war. To children who were left behind, who were paying price, and price that they didn't have to pay, you know, and this sort of thing, who pays a price? And for my own understanding, it's a price that we children pay by losing our families, by being raped as young women, you know, young children, by being a child a soldier, and nobody understands the pain that people like me felt when we in this sort of situation.
Yeah.
We struggle to come here. It doesn't matter what you take, you risk your whole life to come here, to come somewhere where it's safe. Because when you live in war or in fear, it's not safe at all. So we as an immigrant, I speak for me as an immigrant, we don't come here to steal or to get whatever belongs to British people. That's not our aim. Our aim is to have peace, also to contribute in society.
And this was all I wanted, all.
I might be a refugee, because I am, but I'm a human being like you. Just know my story before you judge me. It's all